Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Rick Calvert.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning. Who was out late? Raise your hands. Come on, we know you were out late. Melissa, you were out late? So I met Melissa yesterday at the new attendee orientation. She said she asked a couple questions, and then today I met her coming back this morning from the Army workout. So you're up late and up early, and you're in the front row. This is how you're supposed to do a trade show, guys. This is how you're supposed to do a conference. Who else was at the Army workout? You guys are rock stars back there. The U.S. Army obviously is one of our sponsors. They've been a sponsor for years. Thank you to you guys. And also, anybody in the audience who's active duty or retired military? You stand up. Thanks for your service. Thank you. We got another great day for you guys today. First, I want to thank a few other sponsors. Thanks to our platinum sponsor, Marshall Silver. Anybody at the show last night? That was great. Thank you, Marshall. Who got hypnotized? Did you do anything stupid? You don't remember? Does anybody know if you did anything stupid? We have video, so. All right. We want to thank our other sponsors. Dragon Search, unfortunately, Rick Dragon, who has been a great friend to me, their flights got canceled again today. So Rick and his whole team are not here yet. So Rick, if you're watching the stream, we miss you. I'm sorry you can't make it. But thank you for all you guys did for us this year. .me and IAWTV, again, the IAWTV Awards will be Tuesday night right here in this room. And if anybody's not aware, it's basically the Oscars for the internet. And I can tell you guys this morning, everybody with an NMX pass, if you want to attend, you can attend the Web TV Awards for free. So you're welcome to come to that. So thank you to you guys. Also, we want to thank Cliff Ravenscraft, our director of podcasting with Podcast Answer Man and A to Z Podcast. Podcast One, Norm Pattis will be here speaking tomorrow as part of the keynote with Leo Laporte. Thank you to him. U.S. Army, as I mentioned before, and WordPress. Thanks, you guys. And again, please, a big hand to all of our sponsors. It wouldn't happen without them. Thank you to all of you guys. Again, you guys hear me say it all the time. This show's a dream for me. You guys make this dream come true. It wouldn't happen without you. We do this show for you, so I hope you are having a good time. So please give yourselves a good warm applause. Thank you for coming. Thank you to Justin TV, who's hosting the live stream. Hi, people out there. New Tech for supplying the gear. And Tech Zulu Efren, the rock star, who's always manning the live stream for us. Thank you very much, guys. I want to thank a couple other people that I didn't get to thank yesterday. And again, if I don't mention your name, it's not because I don't appreciate it. It's just because I'm an idiot and I can't remember everybody. Deb Ng, we miss you, Deb. I know she's watching the live stream as well. This is the first year Deb hasn't been here. So Deb, virtual hug for you. You see what a sissy I am? I like cry all the time. Amber, we miss you too. Meshfire, if you guys don't know, there's a little insert in your badge from the folks at Meshfire. And I know Scott, I think, is an advisor to Meshfire, right? He's not really there. Yeah. Oh, he's wearing a t-shirt, he's pimping. You got a little insert in your badge holder. You've got a free code to use Meshfire for 3 months, so use that code and use their service. Ian Cleary, are you in the room, Ian? Where are you at? I hear you, but I don't see you. I still don't see you because I'm... Oh, he's barely in the room. Well, because he came all the way from Dublin. How was your session yesterday? He thinks it went well. Did he do good? His session at TBEX was standing room only. He came all the way from Dublin. He was here last year. Thank you, Ian, for coming so far. And all of our speakers, please give them a warm round of applause. We have awesome speakers. Yeah. Janice Cuban, who I just got to meet a few minutes ago, who's doing some blogging for us. Thank you, Janice. Really, really appreciate everything you do for us. I'm sure I'll remember some more stuff, and I'll tell you about that tomorrow. So this afternoon, our keynote is at 4:30, yeah, with Marshall Silver. So last night was fun. Today he's going to talk about not being afraid to make money. So hope you guys see that this afternoon. Tomorrow morning, Leo Laporte, Norm Pattis from Podcast One, and Noah Shannick from Stitcher Radio. So that should be a great keynote as well. And then we've got the final Web TV keynote tomorrow afternoon. So I'm going to bring out our keynote speaker this morning, Scott Stratton. He's one of my favorite Canadians. He speaks Canadian, but I understand most of what he says. I mentioned yesterday, it was in 2009 that Scott came up to me and said, I'm going to keynote your show next year. I'm like, who are you? He's like, I'm Scott Stratton. Don't you know who I am? No, he didn't say it that way. He was really, really nice. But he said, you know, I'd really like to keynote your show, and I think I've got a good message, and I think your people will like it. And so we chatted a little bit afterwards, and I got to know each other a little bit, and I thought, you know, I think this guy will bring the heat. And he did. And 2010, I mean, he killed it and gave one of the best talks we've ever had. So he's got a new book out, QR Codes Kill Kittens, and it looks like a bunch of you got the book here. He's going to sign the book afterwards. So we're really glad to have him back. So please welcome to the stage at Unmarketing on Twitter, otherwise known as Scott Stratton. Scott?
You can keep playing it. It's a good song. Makes me feel hip. So my torn jeans and my ruffled hair. Rick said, I thought you'd do your hair for today, and I said, this is doing my hair. So I wet it. That's about it. So hi. As Rick said, I'm gonna make Meshfire regret I'm wearing their shirt today. It's gonna be great. But seriously, use it. So I am Canadian. See, we're polite. If I said I'm American, what would you do? Yeah, exactly. That's why we don't get along. I am from Toronto, so if you guys have heard any good mayor jokes cracked lately, that'd be great. See what I did there? I put the word. Forget it. I do this for a living. I just do talks. So it's a very honored, very blessed to do this. And our mayor, our crack smoking moron mayor, has changed my talks now. Because when I introduce myself, because I'm polite and I'm Canadian, I say where I'm from, as soon as I say that, some ass clown in the audience is like, you smoke crack too? I'm like, no, I don't smoke with them. It's a private thing. We don't group smoke. You can't do that. So I'm really happy still to be from Toronto, though, so it's nice. So thank you for having me. This is kind of my return. Like Rick said, 2010, the first book came out, Unmarketing came out then. And we've been on planes and doing talks ever since. So it's very cool to be in the room with fellow geeks, fellow online geeks who don't call it tweezer or book face or, you know, my mom calls it. Hi, Mom. So, yeah, it's pretty amazing. And I want to give you some of my geek cred today if you want to see this. I'm also the inventor of the no button. If you go to no.com, which is n+15os.com, why 15 no's? Because 14 was already registered. So, and if you go to it, it simply says press in dire situations. And since I've talked a few times, I know not to have something streaming, so I'll use it for my phone. And when you press the button, that's it. That's the whole site. So, seriously, that's everything. There is nothing else on that page. So. And if you look at it, and now we've got an app in the Android in the Google Play Store. So, and also, it only does that. So it's just a button. But here's the stats for it if you wanted to see the behind the scenes. So 20 million visits. How much do you hate me right now? You guys busting your ass, creating real content, going to all these talks. How much content? And this ass wipe up here is doing, no, and that's it. 20 million. All right? You want good content? Rip off George Lucas. That's all you gotta do, right? That's how he's gonna sue me now. So the great thing about this is 14 million are uniques. So there's people returning to it. It's like their go-to for all these things. There's 22 million pages. There's 1.13 pages per visit. There's no other pages. I don't know where this stat comes from. And then the average site visitation is 27 seconds. It's 8 seconds long. You just sit there. Where you call somebody else over and press it again, which sucks my bandwidth, thanks a lot. So, and the bounce rate, 90% of people have left, which means 10% are still there. I don't understand how this works. Here's the top no cities in the world. Moscow's screwed, because it's 400,000 people. Ones are not set. New York, London, St. Petersburg, Russia is just having some bad times right now. Warsaw, Kiev, LA, Stockholm, and Sydney. So congrats, New York and LA. You're within the world of horrible things going on. So that's the data for that. This is my keywords, what I rank on Google. I rank number one for every version of no except for no. How much do you hate me right now? I know nothing about SEO, nothing at all, and I rank for all the versions of the word no on Google because, oops, I just threw this up there for no reason. I didn't even make it. I just got people to make it for me. I'm a horrible person. So if you put in no or no button, it's also if you go to instantnobutton.com. It's also because typing in 15 O's is really annoying. Instantnobutton.com as well. It'll take you there. We have about 10,000 downloads of the new the Play Store app there as well. So that's to show you that you don't actually have to work hard to get anything. That's really my message today. Just cater to more. I think 85% of the world are morons, to be honest with you. Not you. Everybody else out there. And what I really get to talk about and what I love to talk about is unmarketing. That's my world. It's what I do. That's the Twitter name, as you heard. That's the Facebook page. That's the website. That's the first book. That's how everything started for me on this side of things. So if you want to bring up the slide, I want to show you these logos here. On the left-hand side of the screen is marketing as we know it in the marketing circles. This is the brand, the logo, the brand identity. It's what we spend a bunch of money on and time and opinion on. And on the right-hand side of the screen is what unmarketing is to me. This is Joshi. Joshi is a poorly stuffed giraffe. And Joshi was left at the Ritz-Carlton, Amelia Island in Florida, a beautiful resort that we've been there. I've done talks at this place, amazing place. We all know Ritz-Carlton for the most part, great brand, great service, everything else. But Joshi was left there, and the family went home to Arizona, and when they got home, the kid realized he forgot Joshi, his favorite, you know, security thing, right? What happens if your kid loses their favorite thing? And who here has kids, hands up, that you know about? That, with under oath, you would claim ownership to. Okay, so when the kid leaves it, it's panic, right? It's freak out time. My son, who's 12 now, when you know he was younger, he had three soothers. Three. Okay, he had one in each hand, one in his mouth. He loses one of those, my day is over, and anybody within 25 feet of us, their day is over. It's like if you lost your phone. Right there, it's like, oh, I got it. It's right here. No, don't worry about it. I talked at a parenting conference once, and I said, which would be worse, if you lost your phone at the mall or you lost your kid? You hesitated. Well, the kid would go back to security, but my phone, no, it wouldn't. So you know what I'm saying. So it's okay to feel that way. It's okay. So what happens was the dad gets home and realizes his loss. So the dad did what any responsible parent would do, and he lied to his kid, and he said that Joshi was on an extended vacation, soon to return, which is amazing, right? But every parent in here should have the same reaction right now, which is, great idea, Dad. You've temporarily suspended insanity until it wears off. So now you got to find him, and this is not exactly a plentiful item in every store. It's a poorly stuffed giraffe, right? It's not like you flush the goldfish, you just buy a new goldfish. You're not going to find Joshi again. So he calls the Ritz-Carlton. Not only do they find him, not only do they find him and offer to return him free of charge overnighted to the family, they also took photos of Joshi on his extended vacation. It's the cucumbers that make the shot, right? Like somebody was about to take the photo and they're like, hang on a second. There we go. Let's do it that way. So this is Joshi at the spa, Joshi enjoying the pool. Again, eyewear make the shot, right? This is Joshi meeting new friends at the bar. That dolphin is inappropriate. Tonight at your little shindigs, your little meetups, your little tweetups, don't be the inappropriate dolphin. And if you can't spot the inappropriate dolphin in your circle, you're the inappropriate dolphin. That's your new hashtag for New Media Expo, by the way, inappropriate dolphin. That's it. I want to see those Instagram pictures as quickly as we can. This is Joshy working loss prevention because he's got to work off his stay since he has no money. And since he's now an employee of the Ritz-Carlton, he has to have an ID badge. If you didn't just say ah right now, you have no soul. The person next to you is Satan if they did not say ah right there, or at least smile, get a little tingly inside. So they took the pictures, Joshy, this ID badge, and a letter from the GM, and they overnighted him. What's one word for this? Awesome, amazing, ridiculous. Whatever that is, it's incredible, right? What do you think the dad did when he got this package? Other than change his pants, what did he do? What did he do? He told everybody, right? He blogs it, he tweets it, he emails, he tells his neighbor, let me give you something more relatable to business. He faxes it to people. This is amazing. Do I dial 9? No, okay, good. But he tells everybody, I've been doing this for over a decade. I've been doing word of mouth and unmarketing and viral type of things. And we've done a lot of things, gotten 60 million views of videos we used to do for clients. I know word of mouth. And there's only one rule. There's only one thing I ever want you to take away from word of mouth. You want word of mouth? Do things worth talking about. That's it. That is it. That's a good tweet. I'll wait. Add on marketing. Hashtag NMX. I'll just wink if I got a good tweet, okay? I'll just do that, and you guys go, just go run and do it, okay? That's good. But that's it. You gotta do things worth talking about. That's it. That's it. That is it. That is the only trick. You can't manufacture viral. You can't make people talk. I have brands coming to me for over a decade saying, here's our video. Can you make it go viral? Like I'm Harry frickin' Potter or something like that. And I can just take a wand and bam, it's viral. Your shitty corporate video will not go viral because it's your corporate video. Because you say so, it should go viral. Or it's just missing one thing. No, it sucks, right? And it will not go viral. What goes viral is what we say goes viral. What the people say goes viral. We're the one that make it. And viral isn't a number. Viral is simply going farther than you can reach. That's it. That's it. But we see these things and think, well, we want to go viral. But here's the problem. We think this is marketing. We think the logo is marketing. Anybody here ever designed or given input on a logo yourself, right? You'll never get that time in your life back, ever. Ever. That frustration, the stress, the losing of the hair, you'll never get that time back, right? People who have no business giving design input give design input on logos. Nobody cares. I'm not going to say nobody cares about your logo, but nobody cares about your logo ever in the history of the earth. Why? Because there's only one person who should design logos. Designers. That's who should design logos. If you can't coordinate your clothing in the morning properly, you should not be giving input on logos. Nobody stayed at the Ritz-Carlton and said the bed was too hard, the room service was overpriced, and the front desk person was a jerk. But did you see the logo? It's exquisite. It's very strong font. But do you know how long it must have taken for this, especially if it was a rebrand, right? Rebrand is Latin for bullshit. That's what it means, actually. If you actually go back into the old days, like in the Roman times, that's what it came out of. So imagine, if anybody here have been on a rebrand or a logo, you understand how long the arguments must have taken. Months, maybe a year or two. A left-facing lion argument, a right-facing lion argument, a font argument that was epic. Right? There's a bold, an italic camp over here. There's a creepy dude in the corner talking about Comic Sans. Like, it's all this one. That's for the designers in the room right there. That's for you, okay? So, and at the end of the day, here's my question to you. Which way is the lion supposed to be facing in the real logo? You know what the answer is? I don't know. And it doesn't matter, because neither do you. And that's the thing, we argue for months about which way this lion's facing when it doesn't matter. Focus on what matters in your business. Focus on, let the designers design, you create amazing stuff. Whether it's content, whether it's products, I don't care. But don't focus on the stuff that has nothing to do with you. That's a huge part. This is the Ritz-Carlton to me. We see a logo, we think, what brand story do I know? us in marketing, we don't create the brand. The consumer creates the brand. You want to know what your brand statement is, your mission statement is? Ask your client, ask your customer, ask the person who reads your blog, ask the listeners of your podcast. They will tell you what your brand is. We don't say, we don't dictate brand. Our audience does. And are we listening? And that's why I love things like social media, is because our audience is talking, and do we want to listen? Do we want to hear what they're saying, or do we want to say what we think they're saying? That's a huge difference, because marketing is not a task. It's not a role. It's not something we do once in a while. We have a meeting, and we'll do a branding thing or a marketing thing. Marketing is everything. Marketing is a verb. It's a tweet. Go. We'll make this trend in no time by using Meshfire. Right there for you guys. There you go. So marketing is not a task. It's not somebody's job, because we keep doing things. And here's where the book came out of, is the anger about this. I'm a huge geek. I've been online since 94. This is the 20th year I've been online. I've been to every site on the internet. Look at my face. I've seen everything. I don't want to, and I can't unsee it. So I'm a huge geek. Anybody geeks been here since like mid, late 90s, early 2000s? Geeks, you're here? Right, good. We'll hang out on ICQ later on, right? We'll do that? Yeah. Right, we'll do that a little later on, right? And for my Uber geeks, we'll make fun of ICQ on IRC chat. That's what we'll do later on, right? Yeah, you know. No, we're a little quiet sometimes, but we can take over the world when we do these things. So, and I love apps, gadgets, data. I love everything about marketing and tech, and I love it. And this is my poster child for the misuse of marketing. While we do stuff because we can and not because we should, which brings me to QR codes. This is a QR code made of Oreo cookies. Don't scan it. Focus here, right here. Stay with me, geeks. Stay with me. Everything in your power, like, must try to scan to prove him wrong. No. Here, with me, okay? The problem with QR codes is not QR codes. I say that in the opening of the book. I come to praise them, not to hurt them. I come to save kittens, not to kill them. QR codes themselves are not a problem. They've been living a wonderful, useful life for over 20 years. They're just a better barcode, right? We've been using them in logistics and in the automotive industry. If you ever open your toilet up, I don't know why you would, but if you ever did, because you're a pervert, and you open up your toilet, and inside of it, you've got a QR code, you see it? That's not for you. That's for warehousing and for shipping. That's why it's supposed to be used. And then some jackass marketer a couple years ago says, we can screw those up, let's use those. And we started slapping them on everything. We started putting them on everything, and this is the problem, okay? On the flight here, there's QR codes in the airline magazine. Think about it for a second. When do you read the airline magazines, if you do? When you're taking off and when you're landing. Why? Because they won't let you use your phone for the most part. I had somebody in an audience at an event put up his hand and go, yeah, Scott, but people could actually, you know, take those magazines home with them. Only very lonely people take airline magazines home. If your target market is shut-ins, then yes, feel free to use QR codes in your ads, right? We're slapping them everywhere, and here's the problem, we don't need to. We're putting all these things, our Twitter name, our Facebook name, our QR codes, our website, our phone number. What happened to focus in marketing? What happened to focus in advertising? We're pushing them farther than we need to, or we should. We're doing things like this, which is a plane pulling a QR code banner. Like, would you? Look at my face. It's hurting me. One of you in this room suggested this to your client, and they went with it. It's a mile and a half in the sky. This is over Lake Ontario, just in Toronto, at the CNE in Toronto. And it went across, and somebody thought this was, somebody approved this. 85% are morons. Remember, somebody approved this. This is the problem. I've seen QR codes on billboards off the freeway. Two problems with that. Distance plus motion. does not equal quality scanning opportunities. The only people that should be billboard advertising QR codes off of freeways are injury attorneys. Smart people got that one. You got that joke. All right. Maybe you didn't think it was funny. That's cool, too. So that's the, but this is the problem. We see in Ottawa, in the fine capital city of my country, the RCMP, which is our federal police, have a billboard that says, don't text and drive. And it has a QR code on it. That's entrapment. Like, it literally knows where you are when you scan the thing. That's not right. You need to stop doing things like this. This is in the book. This is a mall, the front door of a mall. It has a Facebook sticker on it with a QR code beside this Facebook sticker to go to the mall Facebook page. Now, in theory, like most QR codes, in theory, this makes sense, right? Facebook, very mobile friendly. We all know, more than the majority of people who access Facebook will do through from a mobile device. So it's very simple, makes sense. So if you wanted to go to the mall Facebook page, I don't know why you would, but if you wanted to, you could simply scan it. But here's the problem. When you walk up to get close enough to scan it, the door opens. Outwards. Into your hand. It's like a security guy's watching on the camera. Watch, I got a geek. Watch. There he goes. Look at the sign. It's Facebook, and it says, keep clear. Scan here, keep clear. Scan. Make up your mind. We need to think. All I am begging you to do, my fine, friendly geeks, is to think. Think before you do. Think before you QR. Every time we put a QR code in a door that opens outwards, a kitten dies. That's where the title of the book came from, is something like this. But in all seriousness, every time somebody scans a QR code and doesn't work properly, they're less likely to scan the next one. Does that make sense? Right? We're hurting ourselves. When we slap these on without reason, without thinking, we hurt ourselves. Every time we slap a Twitter logo or a Facebook logo on our ad without the address to our part of on those sites, a kitten dies there too. Right? If you have a Facebook logo on your signage, on your advertising for your brand, here's the problem. If you just put Facebook, right, just the logo, and say, well, they can just search us because it's a great search on Facebook, here's the problem. When I go and put in Facebook.com, what happens when you put that in? You're logged in, right? And so you go there and say, look, I'm going to go check out on marketing because I hear he's on Facebook, and I'm going to search him. Oh, look, 7 notifications. What's this here? And you click on that. You're like, look, it's 6 invites to frickin' Candy Crush. And then something else from the stop playing that. And then stop inviting me to play that, by the way. So and I got 17 messages. Then I click on other messages, and it's the worst perverted place in the world. And then you go over here, and you realize you're gone. You're gone. If you're going to use a social logo on your ads, on your marketing materials, tell me where to go. Put the Facebook logo and slash whatever your direct address is, right? Versus just saying, go find me. No, don't do that. It's not going to work. Instead of slap, and the problem is we put a lot of our logos and QR codes on things to show that we're using QR codes and social. We don't want you to do it or use it. We just want to show you that we're keeping up with the I Joneses and we're doing these things versus not wanting you to actually go use them. And that's the problem. Okay, I've seen QR codes in emails. No? Let me give you a visual for this, okay? Ready? You ready? Okay, right. Camera, there? Right there? Okay, good. Ready? It's a workshop part. It's going to be very intense here. Ready? The email comes here. You ready? This is the big part. You got to stay with me. The camera that scans the QR code is back here. I once had a guy at an event, like, there's a camera in the front. So, I'm a nice guy, really am. Unless I'm some sort of Jedi, I'm not scanning your code, right? And I had a guy say once, well, you know what? Some people check their email on their computer still, Scott. Well, then I'm already on the computer. If you want me to go to a specific page on the internet, what else could you put in an email that I might be able to use? Like, I don't know, a link. Nobody's ever looked at a link and said, what's that? What, do I smell it? I don't know what to do with it. Stop it! I'm begging you, stop it. You have the power to change this, to stop doing these things. I have seen QR code. I'm getting so mad. I can't breathe. I have seen QR codes on websites. And I have scanned them. You know where they take you? Back to the website. It's just some sick joke. Does the client want a QR code on the website? I don't know. How much can we charge them? I don't know, a grand? Awesome. Where would it lead? Back to the site. Oh, you're good. You're good. How much does it cost to generate it? Nothing. Write it up. Let's do it. Stop. Stop. Focus. Focus on the base. Focus on what matters. Create your content. If you create amazing content, you don't even have to be on those platforms because it'll spread for you. I think a lot of times it's none of a brand's damn business what happens on some of these social sites. It's for us to share things on it. If I don't have a big following on Facebook, but I write something incredible, then it'll be shared on Facebook. You don't have to be there for the share along with it. Just create it and stop obsessing over these other things. If 50% of your products are get returned within 30 days, you shouldn't be debating whether or not your company should have an Instagram account. Fix what's wrong. Great products, great service, great stories. Right? That's how it works. I couldn't give a rat's ass if you're on Twitter or not, on Instagram or not, you do Vine video or something else. It doesn't matter. Create great stuff, and us geeks will do it for you. We'll spread it for you. Focus on what matters, not what's new. I got a lot of time today, so you can do whatever you want. But this is the problem. I see something like this. Look at it carefully. A giant straw is in the way. Now you're messing with my juice, right? And if I tear off the straw to scan it, do you know what happens? I tear off the QR code. Think about it. I have seen QR codes on bananas, sweet, innocent bananas. And it says, the little oval sticker on the banana, it says, scan here for smoothie recipe. And I scanned it. And it brought me to a video how to make a smoothie, and it said, sorry, video not playable on mobile devices. The only thing that scans a QR code is a mobile device. Nobody's taking their PC and flipping it upside down with a webcam to scan your QR code. Just think, this is in Vegas. This is the taxi in Vegas. You can know it's me. I'm actually in the rearview mirror if you look very closely. This is the Wynn. This is Steve Wynn with his wicked voice, by the way. Great voice. He's got his talking about the Wynn and the Encore. And a QR code comes on the screen. Okay, and he says, you know what he says? Swipe your phone with the QR code. Think about that for a second. So I get my phone out. I'm doing this. But I got my phone out to take a picture, and you know why the QR code isn't on the screen in the picture? Because it's up for 3 seconds. But I don't have time to pull it out, open the app, and scan it. This is the problem. We're not thinking before we're doing. We're not thinking before we launch a product like this, which is the QR code pet tag. Look at the size of the tag compared to the pug's head. It's not very proportional. So, if I lose my cute pug dog or my psycho cat, look at it. There's 378 breeds of cat in the world. That's the one you went with? The hairless cat of Satan? That looks good, Bob. Run it. Let's do this. So if your psycho cat or your cute dog gets lost, I'm supposed to be, well, I'm walking down the street, I'm walking down the street, and I see this lost animal, rabid thing. I'm supposed to grab it by the neck, pull out my phone, find the app, initialize it, focus it, all the while holding down the animal. Have you ever held down a duck? No. Have you ever held down a cat? It will kill you. I have two cats. I've been killed twice by these things. What? I don't get it. Let me give you some data, because I know you guys like data, so let's do this. I'm going to break it down for you, okay? 85% of people in North America have a cell phone. 50% of those phones are capable of scanning a QR code, which is smartphones. 17% of those people have ever scanned a QR code, and half of those people were successful and would ever use one again for a grand cash and prize total of 3.6% of people in North America could be scanning your QR code at any given time. What else can we put on a lost pet tag that would allow us to contact the owner with a mobile device? I don't know, a phone number? That 99% of people with phones can call other phones? I'm concerned about the 1%, but this is the problem here. This is my problem. And you know what my biggest problem is in the mobile industry? And I have some great friends in the mobile industry. But the biggest problem here is the stat, which is this one here, that 50% of people were successful. They use this as an excellent stat, as a rallying cry that half the time it works. What? If the web only worked half the time, nobody would use it. If your podcast only played half the time, nobody would listen. But this is success? Oh, God. This is we're ripe for something else. I told you, I'm a geek. I love this type of stuff. But we're using them wrong. And that's my biggest problem. We're putting them on backs of buses. This is in Atlanta. It says, scan here to view emergency room wait times and hold your place in the ER because you just rear-ended a bus. You know how close you gotta get to scan that? I had somebody in the audience, again, I get the best people in the audience, and somebody else in the audience goes, that's for people walking, not for people driving. Who's walking behind buses? If you're wandering downtown Atlanta, close enough to scan QR codes on buses, we got bigger issues than ER wait times. Okay, just think. Think before you QR. There's some success stories for it. I think closed systems with QR codes are very smart. They've been used for a long time. It doesn't matter what I think about them. They're successful there. Sporting tickets, concert tickets, hospital wristbands with really good patient information on them. In closed systems where everybody has, here, on your badge, the QR codes work. Why? Because the people at the doors have scanners that are set up that I see code, scan code. That's it. That's not what consumers do. They see it, they're like, there's that thing again. There's that ABC code. I don't know what that means. I don't understand. This is the problem. We're forcing tech on our consumers that aren't ready for it because we want to be first. Consumers should dictate tech we use in business, not the other way around. Don't force your audience to go down a road they don't have a car for. Don't force them to go a place they don't want to. Our job with content is to create stuff that our audience can consume in whatever way they prefer to consume it, not in ways where we like to consume it. We have to realize that when we have to flip that around. If you're gonna put stuff on your trucks, on your vehicles, do something like the Shadow Milk Company out of Kansas City, Missouri does, which not only do they show their website and their Twitter name, but they also say, in case of accident, please have cookies ready, lots and lots and lots of cookies. They have an ice cream campaign right now that says, I scream, you scream, the police come, it's awkward. Who here wants to try that ice cream now? That's what's called freaking marketing. That's what marketing means to me. You've got something where people talk about it. That's marketing, yes? Marketing is, I want to go to Kansas City to try an independent dairy company's ice cream. You know how much it costs them for me to show this? Nothing. And I asked them, I emailed them, I talked to people at Shadow Milk, and I said, how'd you come up with this? And they said, we didn't. We hired an agency and let them do their job. I'm like, nice. People here who work in agency or as consultants, isn't that the most brilliant, loving thing you've ever heard in your life and never heard it before? Let them do their job. And I was tired. This is why I don't do client work anymore. I don't have the unagency. We don't use it anymore. We just do talks because mainly because I hate people. But other than that, I was tired of getting paid to tell people how to market their product and then them not doing it. It's much more common than you realize. All my consultant friends here know exactly what I'm saying, right? You get paid to do something, suggest it, and then they argue with you. I once had a client, at the time we'd had one of the most successful viral video companies in the world, right? This is before YouTube. This is before even broadband. This is like dial-up time, okay? And they came to me, and I started telling her, and I actually started arguing with her. Amazing that I do that. I started arguing with her, and she's like, are you trying to tell me I don't know about viral videos? Yes. That's why you hired us. And this is the problem. This is how we don't understand how these things work. We need to let people do their jobs. We need to let people do their jobs that we hire for. The problem is, to me, is data is very dangerous. You've got to be careful, even here, even when you see sessions, be very careful on the data you take with you. Even from my talk, the only important case study, the only important benchmark is the one you've got with your own audience. That's it. Don't listen to this. Don't listen to necessarily everything. Take everything with a grain of salt. Take all data with a grain of salt because there's layers behind it. Okay, as an example, Google Plus or minus, depending on who you talk to. The stat, and people ran with it saying 60% of Google Plus users sign in daily. But when you actually saw the statement from Google, it was actually 60% of Google users who are Google Plus members sign in daily and use one of their services. Like, I don't know, YouTube, Google, that type of stuff, right? Be careful with the data. I don't like Google Plus. You do? Keep using it. Don't care if I like it or not. To me, it's the same people saying the same thing as they were on the other platforms. And people say, but it's good, Scott, it's good for SEO. If you're using a social media site for SEO, that's not social media, right? It's like going to a networking event and just talking in keywords. That's good, right? But if you like using it, then use it. Don't care if I don't use it. We only have so much time, though, and here's the problem in our field and in new media and in social is that we feel the need we need to be everywhere or we'll be left behind. And it's actually the opposite. You got to focus. The focusing, not only in social, but as an entrepreneurs or as people in business, focus is a lost art form. And just focus and use, and I would do that by platforming. I would be on Twitter for 6 months or a year and just focus on it. And then I'd move to another one and move to another one, but not try to be all, I'd rather be on one site and be amazing and be known and be on five and be spread too thin, right? And this is the problem. What we do now and what we do a lot in social is we make it easier by scaling it and scheduling. And if you know me and if you've ever followed me, and some of you were here even from 2010, and I said this back then, and how sad is it that I say it now? Scheduling is the worst thing to happen to social media for me. Automation is the worst thing ever to happen to social media, as far as I'm concerned. Right? Here's my problem, and here's my issue. And I've been against this since 2008, when we didn't call it social media. We just called it talking. Us geeks have been using social media for 20 years. We called it forums, right? And chatting, and it's just people talk. It's not new. We just have a new label. Here's my problem, and this is where I'm still getting into the same debate and same argument. I am incredibly opposed to scheduling tweets. I'm incredibly opposed to syncing updates between platforms, and here's why. Okay? People come to me and say, Scott, I know, because I say when you schedule posts, it's like sending a mannequin to a networking event. Okay? You're there, you're just not there. And people say, oh, okay, Scott, but here's what I do. I schedule my tweets, but I get notifications in email when somebody replies, therefore I'm still engaging. No, that's called being selfish. Because here's the problem. Twitter especially. Remember Twitter in the old days? 08, 09, everybody here from 07? The old days of Twitter? When people were all there who wanted to talk to each other because they wanted to talk to each other? We were just there before the brands came, before Gaga was there, before Bieber, before Kutcher, before all these people were there. We were there to talk. And here's the problem with only replying to people who tweet to you. You're not listening to everybody else. There's no conversation middle. We used to go into Twitter and say, what was Justin saying? What was Allison saying? And some great friends I've got now, some most important people in my life, I met through Twitter because we talk with each other, not because we are being talked to. And you know who the worst person at this is? Me. It's like an A&E special or something. But I'm admitting to you, I am the worst at this. Why? Because I'm so frickin' fancy, and I have so many followers that I only have time to look at who at mentions me, and that's not right. Because I'm not giving to the ecosystem. I'm not investing my social currency in Twitter anymore. I'm only taking. And when you schedule and only reply to people coming to you, you're just taking. You're not giving. You're taking. And then when new people come to Twitter, they say something and nobody hears them because they haven't at mentioned anybody. And if I started Twitter today instead of starting it in 2008, I would last a week and be gone because nobody's listening. We got to start listening again. I don't mean listening because for a brand mention. I mean listening to each other as people. I think Twitter is a people place, individually run place, where it's conversation. Twitter is that virtual networking event, and I have to give, and I've been trying the past 6 months to turn back around and start giving back, and just seeing random tweets and replying to those, and get off my high horse and realize that it's not what it's about. One of the networks that helped push me into the spotlight, I need to give to and keep feeding. Otherwise, we're gonna lose. Social media is losing some of its relevance to me. It's crumbling a bit because all we're trying to do is be everywhere at once, which means we're nowhere else. We're not individually there. We're not talking. We're not having conversations. We're not being social on social media. And this is a problem. I'm not trying to be alarmist and put that in a headline so I can get clicks. That would be a good headline, though. But social media is eroding to me. And I'm the biggest fanboy you'll find. If it wasn't for Justin Bieber, I'd be the biggest Canadian on Twitter. Bieber. But that's the problem. We're not giving back. Give back. Give back to social. If you want to use just Facebook or Google Plus, I don't care. Maybe you're rocking Friendster still. I don't know. How awesome would that be? That's like, that'd be like hipster again. Like it'd be like flipped around with a Friendster or Bebo or something like that. Whatever you're using, give to it. Have genuine, the art of listening has been lost. Right? That's the problem. That's the huge issue to me. Here's another thing about Facebook, okay? We've heard over the past month, especially at the start of December, hey, Facebook's changed it. Now you gotta pay. Now brands have to pay to be in front of their, this is crap. I'm getting 2% of reach. You know why you're getting 2%? Because your content sucks. That's why you're getting a 2% reach. Well, I was getting 8 before, that's terrible. This is my reach over my last 10 posts to Facebook over the past 2 weeks. Past 2 weeks. 101, 103, 55. You know what the 55 was? Me talking about me. Right? And then 294, 79, 175, 72, 82, 55, 190. My low bar is 55%. Why? Because when I post to Facebook, I post stuff I think my audience wants to see and read and consume, irrelevant of the fact if I wrote it or not. And I check out people's brand. I've checked out some of yours. I've seen your bitching. I've seen it. And I go and checked it out. And you know what you've been posting? Crap. Utter crap on your pages. Look, it's us. Hey, look, it's us. Look, it's us. Give. Give to your audience. I send out people things that I read of friends of mine because I think it's relevant, and then they like it. And when you give other people's content, it makes you seem less self-centered and more of a catalyst for content and a catalyst for conversation. And we're losing our mind because now Facebook wants money? What? It's a business. I see one side of people here complaining about, well, we don't want to pay to put our status. The other side is losing their goddamn mind about videos playing in their timeline now. Like, how dare they? You've been living in Facebook's house for 5 years, rent-free. You're coming in, you're posting pictures of your food in my living room, your mom shows up, types like instead of pressing like, and I haven't said a word. I haven't said a word to you. I'm letting you post your passive aggressive, I'm gonna leave Facebook statuses, and I haven't said anything. I let you have your room, and now you're bringing your customers into my living room and you're selling them your Avon products, and I haven't said anything. But you know what? The rent is due. So if you don't mind, and then you lose your mind, you go and you drop a deuce in my kitchen and tell me I suck because I wanna charge you rent now? When you post an ad, you should pay to post an ad. That's why it's called advertising. You want to reach your audience and try to sell them something, you pay to do that. But it's $100. Kiss my ass and pay the $100. They're a business. You built your house on rented land. Now you've got to pay the rent. And if you don't want to pay, then build your own Facebook or build up your own site so you don't have to rely on it. And stop complaining because it makes you look like an asshole. I've been waiting to say that for a very long time. It's really hard to get that across in text, right? It's really hard to get, all caps get tiring after a while, right? You know what I do with my people, my likes or my fans on Facebook? Same thing I do with my newsletter subscribers. I respect their time. I don't say I have to post 3 things a day because I read in HubSpot that they said that's the best frequency to do. I don't blog on Tuesdays at 11 a.m. because that's the best time to send out a newsletter. I send something out when I have something epic to say for my audience to want to hear, and not my own words for the most part. You know when I put a blog up? When I got something awesome to say. And when I don't have something awesome to say, I don't send it. Nobody has ever, I said this in 2010, nobody has ever shared a blog post because it's Tuesday. Think about that line for a second. Well, it's pretty mediocre content, but it is Tuesday, the best day to send content. So I'm gonna share it with my network. It doesn't work that way. And this is the problem. We think the problem is, oh, I know why our newsletter didn't get opened. We send it on Tuesday at 1 p.m. when I just read a study that said Wednesday at 8 a.m. was better. That's why nobody read our crappy newsletter that had the subject line, November Chiropractor News. You know what your content's problem is? It's not the time of day you send it, all right? I'll even use the data here, okay? Which time of day is the best time to send it on a Tuesday? 8 a.m. to 10 a.m., 11 a.m. to 1 p.m., 2 p.m. to 4 p.m., or 7 p.m. to 10 p.m. Eastern Standard Time? What is the best time in North America to send it? Which one of those four? You know what the answer is? All of them, depending on which site you read. So it's only like, I think it's Tuesday at 3 p.m. is the worst. Other than that, I think it's an open world. That's the point, is it doesn't actually matter. What matters is when your audience reads it. So you do split testing. You test it with your newsletter provider. You see when your audience opens it and use that. Your problem with your content is not time of day. That's number 11 on your checklist. Number one is sending something when they get it. We have 3 reactions to email, right? Read it, save it for later when we never read it, or delete it, yes? That's actually why I love email. Email's not dead, and people write that, they're an idiot. It's not dead. It's the only marketing tool we have in this social digital age where people have to make a decision. Delete, read, save, right? Social comes and goes. I'm the biggest social fanboy you'll find. But social has a terrible click-through rate. Terrible ROI. Spam is better, literally. Spam has a better click-through rate than social. Why? Because it comes and goes. It comes and goes. Email, I still gotta make a decision. If we can get through the filters and the new Gmail tabs and everything, I still have to make a decision, right? That's still important. When my son is no longer 12 and when he's 25, will that still be as relevant? Probably not. We have a generation coming up that don't rely on email, okay. All right, but right now it still does. Look at your numbers and look how you can improve them, and don't look at time of day necessarily until you research your own audience instead of everybody else's. And this is the great Twitter reach around for me, okay? I didn't think you'd read that in the morning. So here's somebody tweeted this about an event and said, look, we reached 3.2 million people with our hashtag, which gave us 9.3 million impacts. What? What they did was they took the contributors, I who was one of them, took contributors and multiplied it by followers per contributor on average, and there's your 3 million, and then multiply it by tweets per contributor, and this is our impact and our reach, and it's the biggest hunk of crap I have ever read. Twitter reach is a lie. You are lying to people if you tell them Twitter reach when it comes to hashtag reach. Back in the old PR days, and if my PR friends are in here, we understood that, right? Our like magazine pass along that every magazine sold was actually worth 4 because we leave it on a bus or in a dentist's office, somebody else would read. It's just so full of crap, right? We do this with Twitter. Well, our reach is 3 million because that's his followers. No, what your reach for that hashtag is like 3 people. Your only good statistic is the one you can prove. The only relevant data is the data you can prove. Meaning how many people use that hashtag. Your real reach there is 300 plus potential followers. And there's math and data that says, you know, 10% of 10% but 10%. It's called fractional reaction, we call it. Where it's, if I have 160,000 followers, and at any given time, 160 people will see what I say. That's really what the reality is, right? It's gone down a lot in the past few years. Use data accurately, because when you go in that meeting with sales and marketing, and they have their click-through rates from their Google ad, and everything else, and you're sitting there going, our reach is 6 million or 9 million. How many clicks did you get, Scott, to the webpage? 3. You look terrible. You look terrible with that. And even people are dangerous. Be careful not only what the data does and tells you, but what people tell you, right? I'll give you an example. Hey, this is us. That's me. It's my wonderful woman, Allison, sitting right there. Wave, Allison, for everybody. Could you please? That's Nummy's Bras on Twitter. Say hi. Allison's actually the talent behind all the books and everything. I just rant, and she goes, okay, calm down, and writes everything down in a coherent way. So, and she's also, we're the co-host of Unpodcast. So where's Cliff? Cliff, are you here? Cliff, where are you? Ravenscraft, where'd you go? Cliff, where is he? If he's not here, I'm not going to talk about him. Okay, so we took Cliff's podcast Answer Man, A to Z, or A to Z, as we know it from where I'm from. The whole course, thank you. What's up, Canada? A boot. And so, you've heard that through the whole talk, right? You're like, oh, that's cute. So, we do the Unpodcast, and the thing is, we launched the Unpodcast a couple months ago, right? So, and by the way, I was not ready for the podcast community. You guys are mean. Very mean people. It's very, very protected. So we go and launch it a few months ago. So we're about 9 years late for the party, right? Or so. So we do it in a studio. We get like a 3-camera. We have a video company and we have an audio engineer. So we try to do it as big as we can because we're so late to the party. And we absolutely love it. It's our most favorite thing we've ever done, right? Ever done. So we've been doing it. And our first feedback on our first episode. And any of you know when you create content, you're putting yourself out there, right? You're like, here's part of my heart. Be nice. Be nice. Be nice. And the first comment we get on the first page at unpodcast.com is, I love podcasts, but 56 minutes? Correct, I shouldn't judge before I listen to this one, but 56 minutes? That's it. I know I haven't listened to it yet, but it's too long. It's like saying, I don't like the color of paint you use. I haven't looked at it yet, but it's terrible. What? This is his contribution. He felt the world's a better place when Glenn said this to us. And it just makes me angrier. And then we put you up more on Mountain on the podcast, and then you're famous. So this is how it works. By the way, we're doing a live podcast tomorrow morning, 10:30, right? 10:30 in one of the breakout rooms. We're doing a live recording of it. We will bring donuts. Because that's how you got to get people in the room. So, donuts and awesome. And we're going to send Duck Dynasty up Moron Mountain. So it's going to be an amazing time. We're going to have good. So it's going to be fun. And then in the afternoon, myself and Amy Porterfield are doing a panel on how to move social audience into podcasts. And it's not as easy as you think. So we're so happy of doing this type of podcast, but we're going to get hit. And man, have we gotten hit. But the great thing about community is they hit back for you. And people came back, and some of you in this room do this, and I love you for it, came back and said, 56 minutes, I want it to be 200 minutes, right? When your audience, when your community comes to you, it's a beautiful thing, because then you don't have to say it, and they say it for you. And we actually, the podcast audience, all I said, how me and the industry is, the audience is really loyal and really awesome. And they also, we took 2 weeks off this past 2 weeks because of the holidays, and we've heard it. We've heard that we've let them down because we haven't put podcasts out. You know, why don't you spend Christmas with your family and stop being concerned about the podcast? It's an idea, you know, maybe, or whatever you want to do. So. But even branding is in real time. And that's the thing about social for me, and when it comes to especially with brands, I don't think social is a great sales and marketing tool. I really don't. I think it's a great customer service tool, a great communications tool, and it always has been. But it's real time. Like passively doing social doesn't work. I'll give you an example. I don't want to name the airline because I don't want to be that guy. But I had a problem with an airline. I won't out them because that's weird. But I was at JFK. I love New York City, by the way. It's one of my favorite cities in the world. Vegas and New York, two of my favorite cities in the world. I've had the honor and, like I said, privilege of doing this for a living. We were just in Istanbul, New Delhi, Amsterdam. You can't talk about it. Just go. Or Denver. The Amsterdam of the West. So, really big lines, though. So I go to JFK. I love New York City. I hate their airports. I hate JFK. I hate LaGuardia. Newark's gotten better, actually. But it's like the 3 out of the 4 horsemen for me. I can't stand them. And I get to JFK. So I go to my flight. This is last year on a domestic flight in the States. So I line up, and I'm like a good Canadian. So I get there like 3 days early for my flight. And I show up, and I walk in, and I'm in the security line. I'm doing the Canadian ambassador thing. I'm like, what are you talking about? And I'm handing out syrup, my syrup guns. Yeah. no doubt about it, eh? Right, and going through, and they're like, say A again. I'm like, okay, yeah, here you go. Right, and then so we're not as nice as you think, right? Canadians are very passive in person, but we're aggressive online. That's how it works. So I'm in line, and then about 20 minutes into the security line up here in the Delta hub, they start letting people pass the line who are late for their flight. So I hit stage one of Canadian anger, which is passive-aggressive politeness. And I say to them, they come by, I'm like, no, you're late for your flight. Please, jump the line. Yeah, no, go ahead. Yeah, I was here early, but go ahead. That's cool. Yeah, no. Yeah, I know. There was traffic. Who would have thought? In New York City, there was traffic. After you. Thank you. More syrup? All right, there you go. So I snake my way around, and I get myself up to the front. So I'm getting ready to go through the metal detector. So I do my thing, and I get naked and put it all in the bucket. And I'm putting it through, and as I'm putting the bucket into the x-ray machine, the dance of the flight attendants and pilots happens. You ever been at security when this happens? When they not only are allowed to skip the line, they're allowed to skip recognition of you existing. And they come up and do like, it's like a Cirque du Soleil thing with their buckets in the air, and they literally throw their buckets over mine. If you've been there, you know this, I'm not exaggerating. Over and into the x-ray machine, and they all bump me doing it. Not one excuse me. I don't care who you are. I don't care how many followers you got. I don't care how much money you have. That does not excuse you from common courtesy. Please, thank you, excuse me. My mama raised me right. You don't disregard anybody for that type of thing. So by the seventh flight attendant who's now hip checked me, I'm Canadian, I know a hip check. The seventh hip checks me, I lose it, and I hit stage 12 Canadian anger, which is swearing. And I turn to her, and I say the two words a Canadian should never say. And I turn to her, and I say, come on! That's it. I actually think I said, come on, I'm sorry. Sorry, but come on, right? So, and she turns around, and she goes, what? With Delta on her on lapel there, right? And I say, not one of you says excuse me? Come on. She looks at me and goes, I said excuse me. I go, I didn't hear anybody say excuse me. And she looks at me in the eye and says, well then, open your ears.
Do you know who I am?
And I'm thinking two things at this time. One, I can't believe she said that. And two, this is gonna make a phenomenal story, right? It's content, right? We're always creating. So she goes through saying, I said excuse me. And I get to stage 14 Canadian anger, which is silent, flailing facial expressions. It's like. And I get through security, and she's gone, and I do the only thing that a self-proclaimed diva of social media could do, I tweet. And I say, Delta flight attendant pushes in front of me at JFK security. When asked for release and excuse me, she replies, open your ears. I am so angry. I am so blind with rage. I misspelled Delta. Did you notice it before I pointed it out? Neither did I. And by this time, I'm making my shun list. You ever made your shun list before? What you'll never do with the company again because they pissed you off? I am never flying with Delta again. My son is never flying with Delta again. His unborn children will never fly with Delta. It is going in my will. If you want to make it up to me, I am a big deal on Twitter. I want my own plane. I want Delta changed to Scott. And I want to sit on the pilot's lap, and I want two bags of pretzels, not one, and I want no nasty look from you when I ask for two. And I sent out this tweet, and I'm furious, and I'm sitting at the gate, and 3 minutes later, Delta replies with this, I'm truly sorry to hear this. We expect our flight attendants to be courteous at all times. Please accept my apology. And I see this tweet, and I go, oh, if you think, oh, okay. That's okay. It wasn't a big deal. I didn't think you were listening. How are you? had nowhere to go. What could I say? Damn right you're sorry. Like, what do I got? I got nothing. It totally disarms me. But here is the key, and here's the only thing I want you to take away from this about social. Social, we've heard many times at this event, many years, how authenticity is important and transparency important, and it is. But immediacy is huge on Twitter. If they sent that tweet, but instead of 3 minutes later, it was 3 hours later, would there be a difference in my reaction? Yes, I'd be in the air already. If they sent it 3 days later, would the reaction be different? It would actually make me angrier. And instead, I wrote a blog post on how Delta's tweet saved the brand day for me. And I went from swearing never fly them again to flying 26 flights since then with them. You want ROI? I'm going to tell you something about ROI. Twitter doesn't have ROI. Nothing in business or in marketing has ROI built in. You get ROI from listening and being awesome, and sometimes it happens on Twitter. You see the difference? You can all have Twitter accounts all you want. You're not using them right. They won't do anything for you. You got to listen. Makes you listen. I'm trying to be subtle. It's okay. But this is the problem. We use it and say, it doesn't work. Twitter doesn't work. And I had people say it to me. I've had them say it to me for years. Scott, it doesn't work. And I look at their stream, and it's five tweets all about themselves. And they're like, it doesn't work. It's like walking into a networking event saying, how's it going, everybody? I got to go. And walking out the door. It's not going to work unless you give to it. And this is the big problem with it. But we share stuff on Twitter that makes us laugh, that makes us cry. The person beside you is not laughing. Can you explain this to them? I don't want to sound it out. anybody from Wisconsin? Hands up. Anybody from Wisconsin? Good. You should be louder. You're Wisconsin, for crying out loud, right? Love Wisconsin. It's my favorite people in Wisconsin. Say hi to Sarah Santiago for me if you can on Twitter. I love her to death. There's some great people there. Hate the Packers. Love the Wisconsin. So, Lions fan. You can't hate me. I'm a Lions fan. I have no hope in life. So, right? So, they took this, and this explains people Wisconsin perfectly, right? It's amazing. And they went and they changed it to this when they realized what happened. And I saw that. I'm like, what the why would you do that? I would have driven to Wisconsin to take a picture with their logo. Remember at the start of this when I said logos don't matter? This logo matters. This is the only logo that matters in the history of the planet. And they messed it up. I just want to know how it got out in the first place. Like, none of those people had ever been on the internet. None of them ever texted anybody before. Like, it's amazing. But we share this stuff. Like, this receipt says, I'm not pregnant, but thanks for the eating for two comment. Yeah, ooh, yeah. She took this sitting there at the restaurant table. Gentlemen in the room, can you listen very carefully for a second with me? Just gather around and listen for a second. Never, ever assume she's pregnant. Unless she tells you to your face or you can see the head, do not assume she's pregnant. Take the shirt off now. You don't want the shirt on anymore. We should probably just remove it. That was not part of measure. They did not endorse that. So, but you know how many views it got? 5 million. Why? Because it's awesome. That's why. Here's people trying to leverage social and use it, right? David Meerman Scott came up with a term called newsjacking, which I find very awkward, and I just have been online too much. So, six people got the joke. Awesome. So, this is Facebook, and this insurance salesperson took the photo from their news station. It's a small town in the States, and which posted the picture, and she sends on Facebook, and she shared KJCT News' photo, and she's an insurance salesman, okay? And she shares the photo on Facebook and says, friends, this is why we have insurance. I know it's not fun to pay premiums, kind of like taxes, but we at insurance company are here for you and your family in the event of some terrible loss. I'd be honored to insure you and your families and friends. If you have any insurance-related questions, please let me know. She shared a picture of a house that was still burning. Don't. The best time to leverage a disaster in your business is never, ever. If something bad happens, you shut up or you support. That's it. That is it. You don't leverage. You leverage news like, well, Britney's got a new show, and I could talk about something to do with that. You leverage that. You don't leverage tragedy. You don't leverage pain. You don't leverage suffering. You don't. That should be common sense. And somebody sat there and said, this is a good idea. We wonder why people hate people. We got to stop doing things like this. Or then Skittles comes out and does this and says, think you can retweet this faster than me? Want to race? 1, 2, 3, go. We've just given up trying now. This is by a professional. And we wonder why we're not taken seriously. This is your content? This is what you create? Use your mind. Use your brain. If you have to ask for a retweet, you've already lost. Create things people want to retweet. I saw this stat, and I hate it. When you put RT please on a tweet, it gets tweeted more. No, it doesn't. You have to put it in context. A lot of times when people put RT please on something, it's for a cause. It's for to help somebody. And that's called, it's not, there's not a correlation beside it. It's not even attached to RT please. If you have to ask for the retweet, you've already lost. Create stuff to be retweeted. Create content that will be retweeted, not the other way. When you put your Facebook web address on your sign, right? Right? Little long there. Little long. I'm not going to type that in myself. We are still talking about pop-ups, right? This was a month ago, right? It's still there. This is a golf course that I've golfed at in Seneca, in Niagara Falls. And I got to the site, and this pop-up came right away. This is the entire pop-up. Nothing else happened. And then the checkbox says, do not show this pop-up again. And I had to think about it for a while. Will I miss the blank brown box? What happens if it's blue next week? Is it a trick? How does it work? Months. I understand we make mistakes. I do too. I know. Amazing. We all make them. This has been on there since last year. I've told them about it. Just that Scott jerk again trying to tell us about our brown box. What's the problem with it? We read in a study that brown boxes got clicked through more by 80%. You're making this too easy for us. I'm sorry. Here's a tweet that Sunith tweets in Vaughan, which is north of Toronto, and says, any dealers in Vaughan want to make a 20-sack chop? Come to Keel and Langstaff, Mr. Lube. I need a spliff. I don't know what any of this means. So I asked some younger folks, and they said what he's saying, I think, is he wants some weed, and he's telling people to meet him there. By the way, Mr. Lube, an oil change place in Toronto, he works there. And he tweets this. Can I say that again? He tweets this. It's in public. And so the police for the area retweet it and say, awesome, can we come too? Some of the best Twitter accounts online are police ones, I'm telling you. If you guys can, if you're out with Twitter right now, send a tweet to my crew at YRP, at York Regional Police. They're awesome. They're always good on Twitter. Look at the number of retweets. That's at 3,000 by the time I took a screenshot. Sunith is no longer looking. He's in the market for weed right now. And he's no longer on Twitter. So that's awesome. Here's, if you want to be awesome, do stuff like this. Here's an example somebody posted on Facebook. She says, custom chimney sweeping came to fix our gas fireplace yesterday. This is right before Christmas this year. As the repairman was fiddling underneath the fireplace, he pulled out a piece of Santa's coat and Santa's driver's license and told Sophie that that was why the fireplace was broken and Santa must have gotten stuck last year. Customer service at a whole nother level, so cute. Sophie hasn't stopped talking about it. Now, of course, my sick mind thought, well, Santa died in your chimney. Like he burned in your chimney and this is all that remains. But this is, and you know what she does? She takes a picture and shares it. Is custom chimney sweeping on Facebook? I don't know. It doesn't matter because she's sharing the brand. Isn't that word of mouth? Isn't that marketing? Do something awesome enough that people want to talk about it, but not doing it for the reason of awesome? He didn't sit there and do this and say, this will go good on Facebook. He did it because it's the cool and the awesome things to do. And when anybody else needs a chimney cleaned, who do you think they're going to ask? That's how this works. It's a company here where it says, while digging in your garden, we found some gold coins and hope you enjoy them. This is from a landscaping company at a house where the kids said, hey, if you find any treasure in the garden, can I have it? And they went out and bought gold chocolate coins for the kid. God damn it, that's smart. That's awesome. And I'm hungry, right? This takes as much effort as it does to be a prick. This takes as much, being awesome takes the same amount of effort as being negative. You could do the same thing. It's the same amount of effort. Why don't you be on the good side of things? Then you don't end up in my books and things like that. It's much better, right? Where's Kiki? You here? There's Kiki right there. Good. I wanted to say even, this is your beware of hashtags. Always use capitalization. Kiki runs one of the great Twitter chats, association chat. I just see ass in chat. Which got me intrigued about the chat. And I joined ass in chat. And it was not what I thought. So, capital letters are our friend, right? You saw that when Susan Boyle put out her album. It's in the book, right? Susan Boyle was Susan album party, which actually, when there's no capital, they didn't use it, was Susan's anal bum party, which is amazing. Which, again, I wanted to join the chat. And then it wasn't what I thought it was. So it's amazing. One of the last things I want to show you guys, and I'll get you out of here, is the FedEx story. A lot of you saw this video. This is the guy, the FedEx guy, who walks up to the fence and just throws the package over the fence and goes back to his truck. He doesn't buzz. He doesn't ring. He just throws it. Inside the box is a computer monitor. Yeah. Who orders computer monitors? Geeks, right? There's two groups of people you never want to piss off in this world, geeks and moms. And if they're a geek mom, run. Run. Don't call me. No, I will help you. Run, leave everything they want, and leave and never turn back. They will kill you, nurse you back to health gently, kill you again. They will. And they won't even crack a smile on it. They just do it because don't do it. So he chucks it. He doesn't do it. And, of course, the same guy who orders computer monitors via FedEx also patches into the condo, you know, camera system and records it. And literally uploads the video before the guy's back to the truck, pretty much. That's how quick it happens. And from a branding perspective, can the truck be parked any better? It's beautiful. It's a beautiful thing, right? It's a two logo exposure, by the way, right? It's like a UPS guy backed it in, like, How we doing? That's good, let's do that. Go Brown. So they went and did this. And so it gets like a million views in like 2 hours. It's the fastest scrolling video I've ever seen. I've seen every video online. Like I said, it's the fastest scrolling. I used to do video, that's what our company only did. So I was very in tune with video online. It grew faster than Gangnam Style, grew faster than Evolution of Dance, grew faster than frickin', what does the fox say? Well, that's in your head, I'm sorry. It grew faster than anything. Why? Because we're outraged. I think that's one of my favorite parts about social media and being a really hard consumer advocate for things is that it gives us an even playing field. It's like Braveheart. It's like a bunch of us geeks on top of a mountain. Instead of face paint, it's like ink toner across our faces. And we're just ready to run. And there's one brand with a brochure at the bottom trying to stop us. We now have a voice and a collective voice. And I love it. And there's a trade-off. And there's kind of the gang mentality. And it turns ugly a lot of times. It's an amazing thing where consumers have a voice, and I love it. And so it hit the inner tubes and went out there, and they did a great thing. They put up a blog post that day. If you're in content, think about this. A blog post that day on the FedEx blog, and the title was Absolutely Positively Unacceptable. That was the title of their blog post. Absolutely, period, positively, period, unacceptable, period. And in it, they owned it. They apologized. They said, that's us, that's on us, that's terrible. This is not a good representation of our brand or of our people. This is not what we stand for, and this is unacceptable. And here's what we're doing for the person, here's what we've done about the product, here's what we're doing about the driver. And then they left the comment section open. Oh! Which you never see in a corporate, especially negative kind of connotation post. And not only did they put this up the same day, they put up a video, okay, from Matthew Thornton, the frickin' third came out. They're generationally sorry. Like, it's just, and he came out and he owns it. He looks right in the camera and he owns it. He's like, I'm so sorry. He looked, I wanted to give him a hug. He felt so upset. FedEx made themselves look better than they looked before the screw up. I want you to hear that. FedEx made themselves look better than they looked before the screw up. When it hits the fan, it's not time to hide behind the fan. It's time to be awesome. You cannot prevent the fact you're in the spotlight. You can do something about it. And I got one more thing to show you. And after this talk, I will be at the Barnes & Noble Book Station, which is by registration, only 6.9 miles away. To catch the bus number 5 over there. We'll meet you over there. And I'll sign as many books and any books as you want. We'll be around for the next couple of days. But the last thing I want to show you guys is my favorite tweet of all time. It's not this. It's the reply to this. This is Men's Humor Tweets. This morning, I gave birth to a food baby, and I think Taco Bell is the father. How do you reply to that? How do you reply to that as a brand? Men's Humor has no rules. They're a humor magazine. And Taco Bell replies the only reply they could ever say. They said, I want a DNA test. Thank you, everybody. Enjoy the rest of the day.
Great job, brother. Great job.